Hello, everyone, wherever you are, and I understand we have listeners as far away as New Hampshire, which is amazing to me. It's April 22nd, 2020, and this is St. Mark's at Midweek. I'm Matt Wright, and we have a full plate today. In a few minutes, journalist Lucy Grinden visits with St. Mark's parishioner Ann Brown, a longtime volunteer with the Axe Food Pantry in Altadena. The food pantry, as you might imagine, plays an even more vital role in feeding our community in this time of crisis, and Anne will share stories and details with Lucy coming up. Then, St. Mark's Associate Rector and School Chaplain Mother Betsy Hooper Rosebrook describes the changes in her work with kids, families, and the wider St. Mark's community. But first, our pastor, the Reverend Carrie Patterson Grinden, is here to tell us what's going on at St. Mark's this week. Hi, Carrie.
Hi, Matt.
What's up this week? You cleared Easter. We talked about that, and we've had our second Sunday of Easter, and it's a busy time. Easter doesn't disappear after Easter Sunday, does
right.
it?
That's right. It's a whole season. It's 50 days long, so we'll continue to serve, and we'll continue to look for signs of the resurrection and to be the hands and feet of Christ in whatever way we can right now.
Nice.
So it's good.
What have you learned out on the frontiers?
I get the wonderful privilege of, on Sunday mornings, sitting in the Brown Library, just keeping a kind of vigil, as I've said, and this past Sunday, so the second Sunday of Easter, I was sitting in the Brown Library with the drapes open so that I could see out onto the street, and I had pulled the basket for food pantry donations out in front of the doors of the church, as we've been doing. As I was sitting there, I looked up, and a woman in a mask and carrying a large box of food came walking toward the basket. And so I leapt up out of my chair, and I opened the door, kept my safe distance, and I greeted her. I found out her name was Margie. She's a neighbor of St. Mark's. Mm-hmm. She is not a member of St. Mark's. And she put down her large box of food, and I thanked her profusely, and she says, "I'm not done yet." And I went back into the office and watched as she brought three more full baskets of canned goods, of cereal, of paper products to give to our Axe Food Pantry. So it was just such a great thing to be there and to get to see the way that our ministry is expanding out into the wider community, not just by serving the vulnerable, but also by inviting people beyond us to open up their hearts and offer their resources.
Now, the food pantry, the Axe Food Pantry, is a regular outreach of ours.
That's right.
For people who aren't familiar with the food pantry, what it does and what our connection is to it, can you give us a little background?
Right. So ACTS, A-C-T-S, stands for Altadena Congregations Together Serving. It's a consortium of faith communities and congregations who have fellowship with one another from time to time, and also who serve the community through this and other ways. So its primary way of serving Altadenans and our neighbors is through this food pantry. And it's housed across the street from us on Altadena Drive at the Congregational Church, but it's served by several congregations. We collect food between our congregations, and then we distribute it to those who really need it on Saturday mornings. Each congregation involved takes one Saturday and does the distribution of the baskets or the bags of food. So,
and would it be fair to say now that the need is greater than it's ever been?
It has been great always, and it's gotten greater, as you might imagine, in this time. So we Good. Have some incredible volunteers, and I think you're going to hear from one of them.
Yeah, we're going to. This is your graceful segue right now.
Yeah.
We're going to listen to Ann Brown. Ann Brown had a conversation with Lucy Grinden a little earlier today, and they talked about Ann's work as a volunteer at the Axe Food Pantry. And you're going to hear a lot more about the work of the food pantry and the work of ACTS from Ann Brown and Lucy Grinden.
This is Lucy Grinden. This week, I'm speaking with Ann Brown about her work with the Axe Food Pantry. Hi, Ann. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
So what is it like volunteering at the food pantry right now?
We're really busy, And we have a lot of new people that aren't really familiar with our system. I have an amazing partner, Jim Mars. So the two of us shop together, pack the bags together, and then distribute the goods.
So what kind of complications arise when people come to the food pantry who aren't familiar with the system? Has that been difficult with the COVID-19 crisis, or is that just something?
Well, we're not really sure how they heard about us, because we're kind of tucked in the back of the community church. Our food pantry provides a meal in a bag. So our meal for the third week is chili, cornbread, rice, canned vegetables, and fruit. So it's all in one bag. And if we have it, we give them also a box of cereal. Most of the food pantries, especially if they have federal requirements, they're allowed to go in and pick out what they want to shop. We don't offer that. We provide just a meal in a bag. So some of the people that came were very surprised and said, is this it? Because they're used to being able to pick out exactly what their family needs or eats. Okay. So that it wasn't a major problem, but and in the past, we've had them bring a bag, so we fill it. Now we're providing the bag already there, so we don't have any physical contact.
So does the Acts Food Pantry provide one meal a week as an entire food pantry, or is it just St. Mark's that provides one meal a week via the Acts Food Pantry?
No, there are five churches, and so a different meal is provided every week. The first week is Altadena Community Church, and they provide tuna casserole. The second week is Christ the Shepherd, and they provide spaghetti. Mm-hmm. We do chili, and the fourth week does a Mexican meal with like tostada shells and refried beans and tomatoes, and then we have several fifth weeks, and they do macaroni and cheese with a meat.
I see.
So every week is a different meal, but it is always Saturday morning from 10 to 12.
So what are some of the other food pantries in the area that provide resources to people who need them right now? I'm wondering, because I know that for the St. Mark's community, it's important that we keep this meal going and can meet the demand at the Axe Food Pantry. But what if people wanted to support another food pantry that is giving meals every day or a lot of groceries at once?
We're not really familiar. When this food pantry was started a little over 20 years ago by Joe McGowan, who was the pastor at Altadena Community, we were the only pantry available on Saturday. So we felt it was an offering to people in the community that they'd gone to different food pantries during the week, but on the weekend and with no school lunches, that we would offer a meal to people in the community in need. So we have been told that several of the other food pantries have closed due to the coronavirus. Friends in Need actually closed down. I understand they are reopening April 28th. Mm-hmm. But we really, we're not totally aware of the other pantries and how, if they're giving food for a week. I think Friends in Need, depending on your family size, gives you food due to the numbers. Our pantry just years ago went to one bag. No matter if you're two people, one person, five people, we just provide the one meal on Saturday mornings.
Have you heard from any clients who usually rely on the Axe Food Pantry for one of their meals in the course of the week, but currently don't feel safe coming to collect the groceries?
We have not, but possibly Altadena Community, where the pantry is held, might. The problem that we have there is the pastor that they had as an interim has been called to Wyoming. So The person in the office is only there maybe 2 days a week and not even full days. So the communication as far as them calling, we have had people call and ask about groceries, but not necessarily our clients. But I do feel last Saturday, I've done the food pantry for almost 17 years. And so there are several clients, probably 10 or 12 that I've seen over the years, and at least half of them were not there on Saturday. So I do feel the older population possibly has decided it's too dangerous to come out, or they don't have transportation. We're not sure, but we really saw many, many new people on Saturday.
How many more people would you say you saw on Saturday than usual?
Well, normally we give out anywhere from, say, 20 to 24 bags. Our week does. Our week is one of the lower distribution weeks. But normally we give between 21 and 25. And on Saturday, in 13 minutes, we gave out 30 bags.
Wow.
So it has really jumped. So we are aiming now to give out 50 bags. Mm-hmm. We gave out 45 bags on Saturday.
On Saturday, did you run out of bags?
Yeah, we did have one person come just as we were closing up, but we didn't have any more of our meal, of our food. Mm-hmm. So we closed at noon. She came about 10 of 12. Okay. So we did turn one person away.
Well, it sounds like you definitely need as many resources as you can get right now, especially because as this crisis continues, more people will lose work and more people will need it.
Our church has been so generous and so kind. We have been able, through the annual meeting where people do the food drive, mm-hmm. and Parker did a canned good maze last year at Easter. And so we really have been pleasantly filled our shelves, our individual week, and have really only had to buy canned fruit and cornbread. We've really been pretty well served on our chili and canned vegetables and mostly rice, but our shelves now are empty.
It's good that you feel like you've been getting a consistent supply of resources from the St. Mark's community, but it's also good for us to know that the shelves are empty now, because it's really important that we continue to keep this going and support the community. What are some of the ways that the St. Mark's community can help directly right now? Can you explain how food donations work when we're not actually meeting for worship?
The baskets have been out, and we've been very pleasantly surprised. We've gotten donations. The best thing that can happen is for people to shop off of our menu, which is canned chili with meat, a pound bag of rice or a 2 pound bag of rice. We give out small boxes of cornbread mix or one large box, 2 cans of canned fruit and 3 cans of canned vegetables and cereal and a box of cereal. Mm-hmm. So if we can get donations of our food items, that will make things easier, because before, when we were buying for 75 cans of chili, we now will need to buy 150 cans of chili. And with the limits on the stores, there's no store that we can go in and say we need 120 cans of chili. It's just, the reality is they're not real limits, but they also are not going to let us clean out the shelves.
So it's especially important that individuals are bringing in actual food donations.
Yes. I mean, that would be very, very helpful. The baskets are at the doors to the church. And then if it's kind of drizzly, Lisa has moved the baskets to the bench right by the church office.
Are there any other ways that members of the St. Mark's community can help by volunteering right now besides donating goods and food?
We also would love to have people who are interested to substitute, because several of our team members are on the older side and might be a little bit leery of also being in the food pantry. When Jim and I worked on Saturday, we had masks, we had gloves, and we put the bag on the table right at the opening of the door, and then we stood back. So some people are a little bit more nervous about contact with other people. So if there are younger people that would like to help, the food pantry inside itself is rather small, so we really can't have more than three or four people. There just isn't room to maneuver. But we are always looking for people who would like to volunteer and help staff the pantry. We work the third Saturday of the month, 12 months of the year.
So how can people who are interested in volunteering this Saturday, young people potentially, get in touch with you or let you know that they want to?
Well, it wouldn't be this Saturday. It would be for May, because we only do the third week.
Okay.
So if they were interested in helping in May, or even in the summer, if they would be interested in helping, they can, my number's in the directory, or they can email me, and I will get back to them. The one other item that we could use that we haven't asked for in the past are the plastic bags like that Ralph's is using, or Vons, that are heavy duty, because by the time you put the cans in the bag, it's pretty heavy. So the paper bags break. So if people have extra plastic bags that would hold our meal, we would love donations of those.
So people could leave those with their food when they drop off food at the church.
Yes. Yes. That would be wonderful.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for talking with me, Anne. Is there anything else that you want to add about the food pantry and the work that you're doing right now before we end our interview?
Well, I just want to thank the people of St. Mark's and the school. The school families have been also very generous. I think at chapel, I think Betsy has often had food drives. But the most important thing is if we can use our menu as a guide to what we're donating. It will help us in our shopping so that we can, you know, go in and get what we need without having to buy 150 cans of chili and, 50 boxes of cornbread. And so if they can stick to our menu, that would really be helpful.
Right. I have one of the great bags that the youth group was selling a couple of years ago right in front of me. So I'll just read off the shopping list for everybody listening right now. 3 cans chili.
Okay.
With 2 boxes cornbread, 3 cans vegetables, 2 cans fruit, 1 bag rice, 1 box of cereal.
Perfect.
I think I can put that list in the description for the podcast and the YouTube video as well. But it would be wonderful if people in the community could donate those specific items. Okay, thank you so much.
Right.
So great to talk to you.
And thank you so much for the opportunity to spread the word about the pantry.
Yeah, I think it's really, really important. So thank you so much for doing the work that you do, especially during this difficult time to support the community. It's really, really great.
Well, it is. It is our community, and we are a part of it, and it's nice that we're able to help those in need. So thanks very much to St. Mark's. They really are a kind and generous group of people.
Next time you go grocery shopping, remember to buy items on the St. Mark's list, which you can find in the description below. Please drop off your food donations at the church door or on the bench by the entrance to the office if it's raining. And don't forget to leave some heavy-duty grocery bags, too, if you have extras. If you and the people you live with are at lower risk for getting seriously ill from COVID-19 and you'd like to help out at the Axe Food Pantry on the third Saturday in May, that's Saturday, May 16th, send Anne an email at thetom10@hotmail.com. That's thetom10@hotmail.com. If you'd like to make a monetary donation to help people in our area get the food they need, you can donate to the Los Angeles Regional Food Bank at lafoodbank.org.
Lucy Grinden with the Axe Food Pantry's Anne Brown on St. Mark's at Midweek. Now we turn to St. Mark's Associate Rector and School Chaplain Mother Betsy Hooper Rosebrook. She's worked for more than 2 decades with kids, families, and the wider St. Mark's community. Her work is more challenging now, but you get the sense that it's never been more rewarding. Hi, Betsy, and welcome to St. Mark's at Midweek.
Matt, so glad to be here with you.
Tell me a little bit about your work as a school chaplain, because I think people know you from church, know you from Sundays, know you from your pastoral visits. But they may not know a lot about your work as the school chaplain. What do you do during the week for the school?
The most obvious part of what I do as school chaplain is that I lead school chapels twice a week for elementary students and a couple times a month for our preschoolers. I'm also sometimes in classes to teach or to answer questions or in times of crisis to help students talk through what's going on, have another perspective. I work with our help students somewhat to do outreach in the community and our Haiti program. Mm-hmm. I'm also there for staff members and for families when there's something going on. Maybe someone's in the hospital or someone has died in the family. There's been something else that makes for a difficult time. And so I'm there to support them and encourage them, just to kind of walk with them. I also try and connect with some of the ministries we have in the church as I do that work. So for example, many people in the school community have received prayer shawls that have been made by St. Mark's members. I've taken some of our movable feast meals to people in the school community when that would be helpful for them. And most certainly asking our Daughters of the King prayer chain to pray for people when they particularly wanted that.
How long have you been doing this? You've been at St. Mark's for how long now?
It will be 21 years in June. I came when my children were little, and I wanted to have a job that would give me a little more flexibility with them. And I have loved it so much that I've never even thought about going anywhere else.
Well, so 21 years, you went through 9/11.
Yes.
With school kids.
Yes.
Which everybody remembers, and which was as big a crisis as you can have in a school setting with young children trying to come to terms with something kind of incomprehensible, as their parents try to come to terms with something incomprehensible. And now we have another arguably even more traumatic situation developing, and that must really call upon all of your resources and all of your experience as a priest, as a pastor, as a school chaplain.
It does. Part of the challenge is that, like everyone else, I have no experience dealing with something like this. It's so unique in its dimensions that it's really been challenging to figure out how to continue reaching out and supporting both staff and school families. But I keep going back to what makes a difference before this, mm-hmm. before we were locked down, and figuring how can I offer those same forms of support, encouragement, cheer, faith in new settings. So, for example, I make a lot of phone calls. I send a lot of texts. I write a lot of emails, attend a lot of Zoom meetings. But I'm also learning to use technology at a far more rapid rate than I would have ever thought possible in order to record school chapels. This week, I'm doing a live Zoom chapel with one of our classes, which I'm really looking forward to. And we'll use our same chapel bulletin, and I'll have a chapel talk for them, but it'll be via a new means.
What's the question you most get asked right now from either parents or kids?
When will this end? And that's a great question, because we're all feeling it. I have no quick and easy answers, obviously, to that. I can only offer the encouragement that we don't know when it will end, but we know that we are a community together through it. Mm-hmm. And so we will be able to see it through together with the encouragement of one another. And when any given one of us is having a hard day or feeling discouraged or frustrated, others will be there to walk with that person.
I guess a corollary to that question would be, is it ever going to be all right?
I do believe it will. And yes, that's the other piece to it. The when will it end becomes, what will it look like when we get through this? And I'm a great believer that God's love is constantly with us, that the hope we have is for a community, both local and global, where people care for one another, support one another, help one another. So when we shape that community with God's help and with God's vision and love in mind, we're okay.
I imagine that the staff and the faculty, the administration of the school have questions of their own. They must be feeling this as acutely as any of us. What have you observed in the school staff and administration and the faculty? How are they responding to all of this?
I am amazed by their quick action, the speed at which they've learned and changed, the responses that they have offered to an unprecedented teaching situation. Through it all, they've brought the same wonderful gifts that they bring into the classroom each day, they're bringing into their virtual classrooms, and that's of incredible love for their students and joy and delight in teaching and working with young people, and for the staff in being able to support the teachers in doing all of that work. So hats off to them. They're amazing.
Well, before I let you go, I want to ask you about the 9 o'clock Zoom service I heard we had last Sunday. I wasn't there, but I heard it was great.
It was fabulous. It was so wonderful to see the faces of many of the people who regularly come to our 9 o'clock service, just to be gathered together to share in conversation, in prayer requests. We had David Key leading our singing so we could sing a couple of our favorite songs. It was really a tremendous amount of fun, and we will be continuing with that.
That's great. Well, Mother Betsy Hooper Rosebrook, thanks for spending a little time with us, and I'll look forward to seeing you live and in person at some point before too long, but it's fun to meet on Zoom, and thanks for spending time with our audience on the podcast.
Glad to do that.
Thanks for being with us today. Thanks to our guests and our associate producer, Emily Wright, for her hard work pulling things together. Another update from St. Mark's next Wednesday. Until then, stay safe, stay healthy, and be good to each other. I'm Matt Wright.